What if we read the stars? Say you were made to be mine. Nothing could keep us apart. You'd be the one I was meant to find. It's up to you, and it's up to me. No one can say what we get to be. So why don't we rewrite the stars? Maybe the
Thank you.
You know, I just have to begin by saying I have to acknowledge I had no idea who Edna was when we first met and started traveling across there. But something that I immediately noticed was that we were traveling across the middle of nowhere, the bush. And everywhere we went, everyone we ran into, they would take a little bit of interest in us two gringos, and then they would invariably see Edna, and it was all sudden like we didn't exist anymore, and it was I did not realize the rock stars were, and I'm not just saying that. I'm going to make a statement here that I think is true. I don't think there is a more recognized or revered person than Edna Adan in Somaliland.
Oh. Me neither. Yeah.
I don't think so.
We actually, Dave, toured with Edna earlier this week, a humanitarian facility which had some Somali refugees in it. And we were just kind of talking with the folks giving us the tour, and one of the women ran over, recognizing Edna Adan as if she was Taylor Swift.
Behind the mask, even. Even behind the mask.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
I'm so emotional, I don't know what to say, but it's a great honor and a great privilege to be in your great country and to be invited to join this great doTERRA event. I am so happy and so grateful that our paths have crossed, that you have built a hospital in my country, in an area that had never had a hospital before. And if a hospital ever needed to be built somewhere, it is where you built it, where doTERRA built it, where Healing Hands have built it for my people. And for that, I am grateful and happy. And on behalf of my people, I say thank you to doTERRA and to the great people of the United States of America. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Edna. We wanted to sit down. This is completely unscripted. In fact, I'm going to be honest and say that I haven't even looked through all these questions beyond the first one here, but we wanted just to ask a few of these questions to Edna and just to have you hear her response. And I'll start out with the first one.
Perfect.
That's okay. And then how did you first learn about the Sanaag Specialty Hospital and what did you think about what doTERRA was trying to accomplish there?
Well, I always keep my office door open in my hospital. And one fine day, a very tall American, a person walked into my office and said, "Can I come in?" I said, "Yeah, sure, come in, it's open." And he told me that he was building a hospital in Sanaag. Now, I'm in Hargeisa, in the west of Somaliland, and Sanaag is at the other end. So I said, well, who's building the hospital? What are you doing there? And he told me about, you know, doTERRA. And he said, but I've come to ask for a favor. I said, uh-oh. And I'd like to borrow some textbooks. Now, textbooks in my country,
yeah,
was like asking me for, I don't know, my firstborn or something. I said, textbooks, I don't have many, but what kind of textbooks? And he said he was training some health professionals for the hospital that was being built, and somebody told him that we had a library and we had textbooks, and he came to borrow some. And I said, well, I can let you borrow them, but will you bring them back? I said, yeah, yeah, I'll bring them back. And I thought, oh, well, I hope so. So we went to the library and we looked at what we had, and he said, oh, I need a copy of that. I only had one copy of that, one edition of that. So I said, okay, and I need one of that. So he took three textbooks, which to me is an entire library. And I saw him walk out with my books out of the hospital. And I said, I'll never see them again. And you know what? He brought them back.
Yeah, that's Sheldon.
And this guy had a man bun.
That endeared me to him.
Right?
And that led to the day when I referred to him as my American son. So that was how I met Sheldon. And I know his parents are there. We had breakfast together this morning. And you have a great son, Sheldon's parents. You have a great son.
Yeah, thank you. Edna, looking back through the challenges you faced in your life, which have been many, what tools or skills did you develop to help you overcome the obstacles you faced?
Well, I'm a very determined person. I'm hard-headed.
You have no idea.
First and foremost.
And when I see something that needs to be done, I come from a country with the highest maternal mortality rate. I come from a country with the lowest literacy rate. I come from a country that has been totally destroyed by war. And the least I could do is build a hospital. And if it takes overcoming these challenges, then you just have to do it. Tenacity, determination, and following your heart. You want to do something, you have to go against all the odds. Do it.
Amen.
And the more they tell you you cannot do it or should not do it, your conscience tells you you have to do it, you just keep on doing it. And when I finished my hospital, I thank the people who helped me, but I also thank those who said I could not do it, because they made me even more determined. So, go after it.
You start to get the feeling that you don't want to get in Edna's way when she decides she's going to do something. I would love, her book is fascinating, and maybe you will tell you what that book is, and you'll get a chance to hopefully order it and read it. It's life-changing. But I was fascinated as I read about some of the things you had to overcome, being the first midwife and bringing this professional level of nursing and medical care to Somaliland. Tell us a little bit about some of the challenges.
Well, I was trained in Britain, and anybody from Britain? Hammersmith Hospital? That was my hospital. Great hospitals, great teachers. I was trained for a European environment. But then in 61, I came back to my country, and I was all they had. And it took the government at that time 22 months to give me a salary. So month after month, I would go and say, do I have a salary? I said, no, not this month. Okay. So I worked, and I had no uniform. I had no salary, I had nothing, but I had patients, and I had people to teach.
And you had training.
I had training. If I hadn't had that training, I wouldn't have been able to teach. So I started training as best as I could what had been taught to me in England, but in a different environment, with very little resources, and without supervision, because in the UK I had people that I could go to, and people who would advise me, and people who would show me. So I just did what I needed to do and the best way I could do it. And thank God today we have a great training school. We have midwifery training schools. We've trained, I set myself a target to train 1,000 midwives. And people said, what? 1,000 midwives? You think you can do it? I said, well, we're gonna try, we're gonna give it our best shot. And we have just completed training in 7 different midwifery training schools in Somaliland, 1,007. So now we have filled, or we're filling the base. We need to raise the bar. We need to improve the training even more.
Amen.
We need to train trainers. We need to train managers. We need to train researchers. We need to train so many other different qualifications and professionals. But we needed to fill that base as soon as possible.
We're going to do it with you.
Well, thank you. Right. I need it. Yeah. I need help. I need trainers. I need teachers.
So you've laid out a really beautiful vision for Somaliland and its healthcare. Can I shift gears a little bit and ask you to tell me, or tell all of us, what are some of the challenges in particular that women and children face in Somaliland, healthcare-wise?
Newborns are born to mothers who are anemic, who are malnourished, and who have so many deficiencies in their diet. So when you have women in your countries who are healthy, well-nourished, they give birth to healthy babies. In our countries, babies are born with a lot of congenital malformations, and particularly with defects, neural defects. So they're born with hydrocephaly, they're born with spina bifida, they're born with congenital heart problems.
And infections.
Infections, because they're delivered in an environment that is not clean. Here you have sterile equipment, you have a sterile environment, you have water, you have clean linen, you have clean instruments. But there they're delivered by traditional birth attendants who have nothing to clean their hands. They would just go like this and deliver the woman. So the challenges are many, but you try to do the best you can with what you have. In fact, a couple of days ago, we were doing a whole lot of shops here looking for yarn that I'm going to take back to Somaliland to make cords, umbilical cord ties. So that's how basic things are. The challenges are also the non-availability of facilities. Women would have to travel for days to go to the nearest health station to meet the first trained person there, the nearest trained person. So the roads are difficult, the distances are great. The country is as big as England and Wales combined. So it's distances, lack of health professionals. And then there are harmful traditional practices as well that affect the girls. Female genital mutilation is something that we need to fight, that we have been fighting, and which damages the body of the girl. So, natural causes, disasters, drought, famine, poverty, war, lack of health professionals, and where facilities exist too far, and superimpose on all of that are harmful traditional practices. We don't need them.
Thank you for explaining that. Now, one thing I want to comment on, and that I want you guys all to have heard in what she said, is that she actually went shopping for umbilical cord ties.
While she was
and
here,
While she's here, she says, is there any way that we could get a couple hundred yards of umbilical cord ties? And we're like, yeah. We can do that.
So, you know, maybe along those lines, and tell us maybe what you think about the Sanaag Specialty Hospital. Why is that important? Why is that so important to Somaliland?
Well, Sanaag is very important to me. My father worked there in the 50s.
Father was a doctor.
My father was a doctor, and when I was on holiday from school in Djibouti, I would spend time with him, and I would see how hard worked he was, how hard he worked. how frustrated he was. And that was where I made a promise to myself that one day I would build a hospital. How I would do it, I didn't know. When and how, I didn't know. But it took many decades for me to do it. So when I came back to Somaliland and built my hospital in Hargeisa, I was getting patients from Sanaag because it was so distant. And for a hospital to be built there, if it had to be built anywhere, that is the most appropriate place that it could have been built. So I was somehow fulfilling a promise that I had made to myself and to humanity, and I was linked with a hospital in Sanaag, and that's why it meant so much to me, because so many people would have our services closer to where they were. Over 500,000 of people in Sanaag who had no hospital. So if a hospital ever had to be built, that is where it should be built. And thank you. Thank you for the dōTERRA to do it.
Yeah, it is an incredibly remote part of the country. Edna, would you share with dōTERRA, our family here, what you hope and dream for the women of Somaliland?
Oh, many things, but my priority would be education, because with education you have a base upon which you can build. Education, peace, stability, respect for human life and dignity, respect and equal opportunity for everybody, all citizens of Somaliland, regardless of whether they're men or women. I want girls to become educated. I want girls to become, to have access to institutions of learning the same way that boys have. I want women doctors, women engineers, women lawyers. I want the best out of women of Somaliland, because we can do it. Women can do it. But give us the access. Give us access to institutions of learning and learning opportunities. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
You can, I think you're beginning to see, as we did, you know, as we travel across the country. I mentioned that I didn't understand what kind of a rock star that we were with. And it didn't matter if it was political leaders, it didn't matter if they were successful business people, it didn't matter if they were in the remotest Frankincense village in the middle of nowhere, it didn't matter. Wherever we went, with Edna, it was, people were just stunned, shocked, starstruck. And you know, and you can begin to see why. You can begin to see why. It's just such
I love my people.
Such a power.
I love people.
She's blessed lives.
And I love my people because they have been so forgotten and so isolated. But I'm blessed. I'm blessed because I have friends like you and others, and I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing today without all of you, your prayers, your support, your encouragement, your energy energizes me, and there's so much that needs doing out there, so thank you.
Maybe one final question.
Yes.
Like I say, we could sit here for another hour go on. And I'm trying to figure out which one to go to, but these last two are a little bit related to me, and it's about doing things the right way. Why is that so important? And Dr. Osguthorpe mentioned earlier, I remember seeing this first time. I think Edna has her fingerprints on most medical people in Somaliland. But whenever we would meet a group of nurses or doctors, I remember the first thing that caught my attention was she said, "Show me your hands." And they'd whip them out from their robes. And
seriously, every nurse would go like this. Yeah.
"Show me your hands." And they'd
been
whip
trained.
These why was that? Why is this important to do things the right way? Why is that?
David, they're health professionals. Yeah. My hands need to be clean. My nails need to be cut. I have to have my rings off. So if somebody has come to work with rings on and nail varnish and long nails and dirty nails, they haven't come to work. So if I see clean hands, I know this person's been doing good work. Less contamination. I don't want my patients to be contaminated by the hands of a health worker who did not wash their hands, who did not cut their nails. So we're here to cure patients, not to become a source of infection for the patients who come to seek our help. So, hands are clean, I can work with you. Your hands are dirty, you have to go back there, cut your nails, clean your hands, and then we can talk.
Maybe we all need to take a look at our hands from time to time, huh?
Good idea.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Well, we just wanted you to meet this amazing person. We, as we travel through the world, we meet some amazing people, but none have topped someone who's had the impact that I have ever personally seen than Edna Adan on a country like Somaliland.
And David, I was taught to do things the right way. That's how I was trained. There's one way to do things and it's the right way. No shortcuts. If I'm gonna take shortcuts, what's the point of building a hospital? I cannot teach if I am not performing to the best of my ability, if I am not respecting the dignity of human life, if I'm not respecting the confidence that is placed in me by my patients. I need to honor my patient. I need to respect my patient. And my patients trust their lives with me. They have to trust my word as well. So it's how I was trained. And that's how we should do things. Do it by the book. Do it as best as you can and as correctly as you can. Otherwise, don't waste their time. Don't waste your time. Do something else. But don't look after the sick.
Thank you, Edna.
Thank you, Edna.
Thank you. Take a look at the book, guys.
What if we read the stars? Say you were